Do you know what to check for to make sure that your website is keyword accessible? Do the developers that you work with know what to check and why? Hi, this is Stephen and welcome to Exploring Accessibility. Recently I've been thinking a lot about keyboard accessibility, mainly because my employer is planning on having a keyboard-only day this year, as well as a screen reader-only day. In preparation for this, I'm putting together some documentation for the other developers at the company, explaining what to check for and why. The goal of this day is to give our developers an idea of what it's like for our users, especially our users who have no choice but to use a keyboard. Another aim is to identify all the issues that there are currently with our website so that they can be fixed in future sprints. Also, in the future, we actually want to start testing the website with users with disabilities to see what issues they find. Obviously, there's no point asking people to come and test the website if we know that it can't actually be used just yet. A lot of people seem to be under the impression that keyboard accessibility means just being able to tab from field to field, but there's a lot more that actually needs to be checked. So what exactly should we be checking to make sure our sites are keyboard accessible? Put simply, everything that you can do with a mouse, you should be able to do with a keyboard. The entire website should be usable via keyboard. You should not have to resort to using any kind of pointing device. First, check that all links and buttons and other interactables are actually reachable via keyboard. Lots of things might not be in your website if your developers have, for example, just added click handlers to spans or div tags. Second, all focusables should have a focus indicator. This should be highly visible with enough contrast to make it distinguishable from anything else on the website. It should be clear straight away what is focused and what isn't. Third, anything that is focusable should also be interactable. What this means is that once you've achieved focus, you should actually be able to control whatever it is via the keyboard. Fourth, anything with a role should be focusable. This means if your developers have used a role attribute anywhere in their pages, you need to identify those components and make sure they conform to the keyboard requirements of those roles. This can be done by going to the Authoring Practices Guide, or APG for short. Please see my previous video on the APG if you're not sure what this website is and how it can help you build accessible components. In addition to keyboard controls, there is expected state handling and CSS styling which needs to be implemented if you create any of these roles yourself. Again, all of this information can be found on the Authoring Practices Guide website. See the link below in the description for more information. Fifth, all clickables should be focusable. What this means in practice is identifying everywhere in your website where developers have done things that they maybe shouldn't have, like putting click handlers on spans and divs. Of course, this goes against the rules of ARIA. If you want a link or a button, you should actually use the correct semantic tag. If you're not sure what the rules of ARIA are, please see my previous video on the subject. There's a link in the description below as well. Sixth, check the order of navigation. Make sure that you go through everything left to right, top to bottom. Make sure things are actually rendered in the DOM in the order that they're focused on. You shouldn't be jumping all over the page as this will just confuse some users, for example, people with cognitive disabilities, elderly, and maybe people that aren't used to using computers. These are all the kinds of people that we also have to consider when it comes to accessibility. Remember that not everyone is using a normal keyboard. Not everyone has an Apple Magic Keyboard or a Logitech gaming keyboard. Some people can only use one hand and are using a special one-handed keyboard. Other people have to interact with their keyboard controlling some kind of stick, either supported on their wrist or connected to some part of their head. This is also why it's important to make sure that the structure is correct so that they have to press the keyboard as little as possible, because for them it can be quite time-consuming. Seventh, tap indexes. This should be left at -1 or 0. There's no real need to actually increase tab indexes past 0, and it should be avoided. Lots of developers do this to control the flow through a form rather than actually changing the rendering order of the form fields. If your developers are actually doing this, you should ask them to restructure their form so that users can tab through it without higher tab indexes. If users are jumping all over the place in your form, it can be very confusing, especially for new users or people with cognitive disabilities. This is the H&M website. We'll just have a look through and see what we can find. So one thing I noticed is that it's really difficult to hit this hard. So it's definitely not somewhere in the DOM where it appears. Okay, it's gone past everything. Still can't find it. I cannot tab to this. It's actually a button with a button tag, so it should actually be reachable. Keep tabbing, see what happens once we get to the end of the page. Of course, it's got infinite loading, so it's loading new stuff all the time, which is really annoying as well. Makes it very difficult to navigate to the bottom and get to the footer links. Still can't reach it. Gone all the way through the document and can't actually arrive on it. It's not possible to add this to your wish list. Just open the developer tools and see if it's possible in mobile view. Yeah, on mobile view you can actually tab to the wishlist button. Ah, and you can on desktop view after you've been on a mobile view, which is really odd. So once you've gone to a mobile view and then gone back to desktop view, you can actually reach the add to wishlist button with keyboard. But it seems like only once. Ah, there it is. That's very strange. But this is the kind of thing that you need to look for when doing your audits with a keyboard. It's whether everything is actually reachable and consistently reachable. Here you can see it depends on the size of the browser window. And sometimes just good luck, it seems, as to whether you can actually focus on it. So this is Google. Let's have a look and see how they do. So this is a very simple page. There's not much here. So let's just try tabbing through it and see what we can find. Okay, they have focus indicators, but not very consistent. Some of them have grey backgrounds, others don't. Now we're on the main input. So there are two buttons there for different types of search, and they don't have any focus indicator at all. Obviously, there's a tooltip, but whether that's enough to indicate that you've got focus, I doubt it. Yeah, that's nice. And this is the main page. It's basically what we had before. Here are the skip links. And there's lots of inconsistent highlighting and focusing. Some with buttons, some have focus indicators, some have grey backgrounds, even when they're the same shape. Some of them have backgrounds, others don't. We tap now, we've lost focus. Don't know where we are, we're on something. If we keep tabbing, we'll arrive on all filters. So we're previously on one of these links. So if I go back, should now be on books. Yep. So that's a bit disappointing. None of these links actually show focus at all, which is surprising considering how large Google is. But I guess it's proof that however large you are doesn't mean that you get accessibility right all the time. So this is Sainsbury's. This is a UK supermarket site, quite a large supermarket. And we'll have a look through some of their issues. So the first one that I noticed is that they have this login menu. It appears here, but you can't actually get to any of the elements that are actually in it. If I keep tabbing, it just goes further through the page content. And trying to press up and down to maybe focus on the links also doesn't work. So let's go backwards through the links. Nope, still not found. That's not possible with a keyboard to log in at Sainsbury's. So let's just search for something that you might look for at a supermarket. And it's 354 results. There are options to further filter. And there's this filter drop-down, which says zero, which gives the impression that there are no filters. But if you actually open it, you'll find that there are filters, and it opens a little sidebar. Except we're not focused on that. We're still focused on the content outside of this filter modal, and this should not be the case. If you're using your mouse and you try and click these elements here in the background, you won't be able to without closing the filter modal. So we'll just keep tabbing for a while and see if we can actually reach the filters. Ooh, 186 tab presses later, we've actually arrived in the filters. This is not great. You imagine trying to press tab nearly 200 times when you're using a stick in your mouth or attached to your forehead. That's really bad. And just close it. And we're now located somewhere completely different. We've gone right back to the beginning. They really should focus when the filter modal closes back onto the filter button. Some other things that they do that are a bit strange that you shouldn't do. So here's an example of something strange. They've actually got a span with the strike price, the previous price, and they've given it a roll image. Why they've done that, I have no idea. Maybe it was an image before, and they just left it there. But it's really not. As you can see, it's just text that can be changed. So there's absolutely no reason at all why this text should have image role. And here's another example of something you should try and avoid. There's no reason to use the role attribute on a button. It's a semantically correct button element, but for some reason they've given it a role of button. There's no need. This button tag has an implicit role of button. There's completely redundant information, as is tab index 0. That's also not necessary here. So there's a few things that you can find on real world websites. Obviously some of these things are minor, other things are more important. And obviously I'm not suggesting that these developers don't know what they're doing. We don't know how complex these websites are, how old they are, how many developers are working on these sites. So it's not to point at any particular developers of any sites and say that they don't know what they're doing. It's just to show you some of the things that you have to look for when auditing your sites for keyboard accessibility. Lastly, what you can also do is run a keyboard only day for your developers. Like I said at the beginning of this video, this is what my employer, MediaMark Saturn Technology, is planning to do sometime this year. And hopefully this will be a regular occurrence for new joiners. The aim is for developers to interact with the website just using keyboard. Obviously, while developing or using developer tools, they can use a mouse. But as soon as they stop doing any of these things and start interacting with your website, they should only use a keyboard. This will make it clear quickly to them what works and what doesn't, where there are problems and issues, and where there could be improvements made. It will also help you prepare your site to make sure that it can be audited for the European Accessibility Act in 2025. If your website isn't navigable, you're going to fail an audit before they even leave your homepage. If you don't know what the European Accessibility Act is, I also did a video on this last year. You can have a look at that as well when you finish this video. In addition to keyboard-only days, you can also have screen reader-only days with a similar goal. Instead of just using keyboard to interact with the website, developers should just use screen readers. And app teams can also get involved with this and have a touchscreen-only day. So what do you do when you're auditing your websites for keyboard accessibility? Did you think I missed anything out? Is there any additional steps that you think need checking? Please use the comments below to let myself or others know. I'd be very interested in hearing your opinions on keyboard accessibility for websites. Thanks for watching this video. If you liked it, please give a thumbs up and subscribe if you'd like to be notified about more videos exploring accessibility.